Elliot would always be like just recording constantly, you know, to just to get the ideas captured when they were available or fresh and working them out in his head and working them out on tape. The initial sessions for the self-titled record began like just a few months later with sessions at Tony Lash's house.
I'm Tony Lash. I met Elliot in high school. We played together in Heat Miser. I was the drummer. Now, I just remember offering for him to come over. You know, I was just living in this house and shared a basement studio with a couple guys, and we had a couple of decent condenser mics and a half-inch 8-track. So it was definitely a huge leap in the quality over the kind of crappy cassette 4-track that he had used. And he really just came over that one day before he started working with Leslie, the day when he recorded Needle in the Hay and at least the beginnings of Alphabet Town. Elliot came over, got him set up. You know, I threw the best condenser mic that I had at the time on his acoustic guitar. We got a level, and then I went upstairs to make some lunch. And he was working down there, and I couldn't really hear what was going on because he was so quiet. You know, my memory is just in the time it took me to make lunch and eat it, and then going back down there to check on him, he had already recorded the two guitars and the doubled vocals for Needle in the Hay, and it just, you know, it's so good. And I was just really struck by how quickly he did that.
Your hand on his arm, a stack charm around your neck, strung out and thin, calling some friend, trying to cash some check. He's acting dumb, that's what you've come to expect. Needle in the hay, needle in the hay, needle in the hay.
You know, you can hear the precision in the guitar playing and the vocals. The mood was in place. You know, it didn't feel overworked at all. He was just that good of a musician and must have had a really clear idea before he sat down how he wanted that song to feel.
My name is Leslie Uppinghouse, and I recorded the Elliott Smith self-titled record at my home in North Portland.
So Needle in the Hay, it's interesting that it was recorded before, if it was sort of the genesis of the sound that he wanted to carry through, because it fits very beautifully throughout the record. I don't think anybody listening to it would necessarily pick up on, oh, this was totally recorded in a different space or a different time. It really sets a tone for the record. It really sets the mood for the record. And that quiver in the vocal at the beginning is sort of a tentativeness. It doesn't come in with confidence, and that vulnerability of expressing what you want to say by singing it as a man, having that little hesitation and that little quiver, you hear that fear and sort of that fear of expression in that first song. And you hear it so poignantly in that vocal, that first vocal. It comes in so quiet and so afraid. And I think that's a really cool, special thing that it takes a real bravery to leave on a record, to be comfortable leaving that out there.
I'm Slim Moon. I run the record label Kill Rock Stars and founded it back in 1991 and put out Elliott Smith's second and third albums. I got asked to do spoken word on this tour of solo artists. That's definitely how, when I met Elliott and got to know him. The first night of the tour was at the Crocodile Lounge in Seattle, and I missed Elliott's set. And then while Sean Krogan was setting up, the first thing he said before he played his first song was, "Everybody who just missed Elliott Smith missed something special." So I took that to heart and made sure to watch Elliott's set the next night. I had already done my set at Bottom of the Hill in San Francisco, and then he played, and his set just blew me away so much that I went out to the van to listen to his CD, which, you know, of course he was selling at the merch table. And I just listened to it over and over for the next several hours while the rest of the show happened. And, you know, was just a complete and total fan of his music from then on.
It certainly was new. It was definitely new. I mean, what he was doing was not like, now we think of the singer-songwriter and the like indie pop singer-songwriter is like a thing. What he was doing was really not happening. There was folkies and there was bands, but there wasn't really this like singer-songwriter element. There had been, but at that moment in time, it was so different that it was kind of startling. And just being out there alone with a guitar on a stage and playing really quietly, that was really unusual and special. And I think the people that were at those shows recognized that.
It was really out of step for somebody in the sort of indie slash punk space to be playing under their own name, solo acoustic, without any odd bells and whistles, no funny drum machine through a tube, or, you know, just with a capo and, you know, like a folk musician. But it's really hard to be incredibly captivating with just voice and guitar, with songs you wrote for yourself, about yourself. And he had that ability just to deliver as emotionally gut-wrenching of a show as any show you could possibly see of any lineup, but with that minimal presentation. And that's what I was really impressed with, was how much power he could pack with just the guitar and voice.
When I would be his audio engineer for live shows, you would go into big, noisy rock rooms. I mean, these are rooms that hold several hundred people, and they're noisy and they're loud. And he would start typically those sets with Needle in the Hay, and you could hear a pin drop by the second phrase. I mean, people would be standing, just holding their glasses, scared to like take a sip, because it was just, it just brought everybody's attention into focus. And so that song, I'm really happy, is the first song of the record, because it just brings in whoever's listening to the record into the super tight focus, to where all of a sudden you're paying attention.
The first couplet is a total grabber. Yeah, it's just like totally sucks you in. And then you're on for a ride all the way.
The little guitar figure on Needle in the Hay is just brilliant. It isn't like he's just doing a throwaway part on the guitar and the words are really good, or it's a really cool guitar part and the words aren't that good. It's like, it's a really economical, interesting, captivating guitar part with a lot of insistence, tension, and everything, and really good words with humor thrown on top of it. And you're just like, this is like a quadruple whammy of like how to do it right. Why do you think the song has resonance? It's all those factors. And most people don't hit two of them. You sit in like four or five things out of the park with that. Everyone else, give up.
Yeah, and I mean, I like the ambiguity of the beat. You know, you can't really tell at first where the one is, or like, you know, what beat the changes are happening on until it gets into the vocals. And even then, I remember feeling like there's a little bit of rhythmic ambiguity there that adds a nice tension to what's going on. Yeah, I mean, it's a really great song. I might be imposing my present day interpretation on it, but I mean, it's a standout song, but then also it was reinforced by it being the first song on the record and then it being in Royal Tenenbaums. But I must have realized it was a big leap ahead for him compared to that first record.
It's got a very fat sound to it, a very low-end fat sound. But if you scrutinize that a little bit, it's not bass, it's actually a fat mid-tone. And the whole record is very heavy in the mids. And mids are the range that artists really ignore. And it's too bad, because that is the range that everyone's voice is most present and most comfortable, are in those heavy mids. It's a beautifully recorded song, and I think it's a beautifully written song. I think Needle in the Hay goes down as, it's important in the history of songs.
Down, downstairs to the man, he's gonna make it all okay. I can't be myself, I can't be myself, and I don't wanna talk. I'm taking the cure so I can be quiet wherever I want. So leave me alone, you oughta be proud that I'm getting good marks.
When he wrote Needle in the Hay, when he started to play around with those concepts, even though I don't know if he was doing drugs yet, but even though I don't think he was, I started to react to that. There's songs where I felt more like I could hear his voice, and then other ones where I was just like, why? Why are we doing this? Why are we going in this direction? And it was hard. It was hard to hear, you know, it's hard to hear somebody you care about flirting with heroin. And obviously it went from flirting to using.